supporting me. Come to give God praise, honor, and glory on this morning. Thank God for Jesus. We gotta have our invocation by Minister Ben. And after that, we'll have the devotional service.
Church, say amen.
Amen.
First of all, I can say happy Mother's Day to all the mothers in your house.
Amen.
God bless you, bless you, bless you. You bow here in the moment of prayer. Father, in the name of Jesus, we come this morning. We bow here as we come with humble hearts. First of all, we want to tell you thank you. Thank you for last night rest. Thank you for early morning rising. Our Father, we realize you watched over us all last night as we slumbered and we slept. And early this morning, you taught our body with a faith of your divine love. Woke us up on due time. Oh, you start us on another day's journey. Our Father, we still close in our right mind. Still have the activity and use of our limbs. The blood is yet running warm in our veins. We just stop by to tell you thank you. Oh Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your mercy. We pray that you forgive us for every sin, every shortcoming. Have mercy right now. Oh, your mercy woke us up this morning. Oh, your mercy started us on our way. Your mercy got us calling on your name this morning. Your name is a bridge over troubled water. Your name is a shelter in the time of a storm. Oh, your name is all we need to trust. Have mercy right now. Lord, we thank you this morning. For the food on our table. Thank you for the clothes on our back, the roof over our head, even the bed we sleep in. Oh, the cover we cover with, the pillar we lay our head upon. Lord, we could have been under the bridge. Oh, we could have been sleeping in our old car. But we thank you for your grace. Oh, we thank you for your mercy. For your mercy and your grace is all we need, my Father. We pray that you bless right now. Bless the chicken sitting. One less fortunate one, a porter's offering. Touch them right now in the name of Jesus. Hold them in the hollow of your hand. We know if you hold them, everything is going to be all right. Our Father, we thank you this morning for everything that you've done for us. Oh, you've been better to us than we've been to our own self. Thank you, God. Oh, thank you this morning. Bless every mother right now. Hold them in the hollow of your hand. Bless them when they're coming in. Bless them when they're going out. Name by name. One by one. Oh, Lord, you can do it. You've done it so many times before. Have mercy right now. Thank you, God. You've been good to us. Bless each and every family that's represented here today. Bless their home and bless their family. In the name of Jesus. Remember the sick and shut in. The one that's fortunate, while the porter's off, and touch them right now in the name of Jesus. We know you can. You've done it before, my Father. You can do it again. Have mercy right now. Dear my Father, we thank you right now. Bless our pastor. Bless his home. Bless his family. In the name of Jesus. Bless the ones that are on the way. Protect them, lead and guide them. In the name of Jesus. When this life journey is over, Lord, we can't pray no more. We can't sing no more. And we too must go into our room and never come out again. We pray that you receive our soul a resting place somewhere in thy holy kingdom. These and many other blessings. We ask in thy son Jesus' name we pray. And the church said amen.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
abundantly above all that we ask or think. That's the God we serve. Thank God for Jesus. Amen. At this time, Sister Pam.
Good morning, Mount Nebo. Good morning, Mount Nebo. I am excited this morning. I pray it's in the voice because this is Mother's Day, y'all. Amen. This is Mother's Day. And I say that because it's not just the day that should be observed just on this day. Amen.
Amen.
But we stand and I would have, of course, with the blessings of our pastor, Pastor McKenzie. God bless you. Thank you so much. And of course, give him a hand clap. Amen. Shepherd of this house. Amen. We do, of course, acknowledge, of course, our First Lady of the House, Lady McKenzie. Amen. God bless you. Amen as well. And we, of course, acknowledge all of the mothers that are here with us this morning. Amen. We're going to ask if all of our mothers will go ahead and stand. Go ahead and stand if you are a mother. And let's put it this way. Even if there's a paper that says that you adopted somebody, stand. Amen. If you're a grandmother that has taken on children, stand. Amen. If you are the godmother that has taken on, stand. Amen. See, it's not just about birth, mother. Okay? But in our legacy and in our genes, we share a lot. God gave us a lot to exert and a lot to share. We, as I'm just going to say it, as black women, we have encountered things with children that none others would encounter, amen? And we have brought them through because today they're the ones that are sitting in the White House. They're the ones that are the doctors, the lawyers, amen? So let's just give them a hand clap of praise as well for what we instilled them. I'm not going to have you stand so you can sit back down for 2 seconds. I just want to share one thing with you, and then we're going to have our young people come out. We have one little thing that we want to do this morning, and again, we're just so excited to see everyone that is here. And to say, while Mother's Day is a time of celebration, I just want to say again, just briefly, some of the things that mothers do. And if you agree, just raise your hand as I go. Mothers are nurturers. Y'all agree? Caretakers. Teachers. Nurses. Cooks, protectors, therapists, maids, chauffeurs, researchers. Now, how many book reports we got? Some three. Oh, thank you, Todd. Thank you, Todd. Thank you, Miss Kim. Book reports. How many? That's what I'm saying. Who's done the report? But we'll leave that right there. Advocators. Safety blankets. Schedule keepers. I see some of you just went ahead and kept your hand up. Just go right. Now this I can relate to. Clothes finders. Where is this, that, this? Here we go. Shoe finder. It's right in front of you. Toy finder. Nose wiper. Nightmare chaser. Now all of this, think about it sometimes. We do all this before we go to work. Amen. Give yourselves a hand clap right there. These are things we do before we go to work as mothers. We also understand that today being Mother's Day is still a struggle for some. Amen. I was okay. I was good till I start driving here. And then, you know, you say when something hits you, I wasn't thinking about it, and then it hit me. It hit me. It's still there. It hit me. I had a grandmother who became my mother. Okay, but I had a mother. My mother and father just said, go, just go ahead, because that's your parents. You know, my grandparents raised me. That's my parents. Okay? But my mother and father was right there. But my grandparents instilled something in me, whether like it or not, it's a hardship. I think I can endure anything. I say I can build a house. I can build a 10-roof house if it comes to that. Amen. I thank God for what the country instilled in me when I went there during the summers. There's nothing like it. And I hope that young people, some of you have those stories. Do not on today let it go by without you saying Happy Mother's Day to your parents, grandparents, whomever it is that has taken the time to raise you. Amen. And whatever it is that you're doing. Today, women, pamper yourselves. It's been 3 years we've been in this situation. Pamper yourselves today. Just say, this is my day. Amen. So we're going to ask all of our mothers again, if you will stand, please. Amen. And we're going to ask our young people if they will come out. We have a little token of something we want to share with you this morning. Of course, the First Lady receives first. Jazz, if you'll come right here, First Lady receives first. Not this time, Pastor. Pastor's always the first to receive. So this time, the First Lady receives first. And with that, then we will distribute to all of our mothers that are standing. Amen. Give them a hand clap. It's something you just take it today to pamper yourselves with. Amen. Amen. We need another young person to help run and give. Are we good? Hey, come on over this side. Come on over this side. Amen. And as they are giving, if I may, Pastor, if I may take privilege this morning, there are a couple of women that I do just want to, and Mount Nebo, please, I ask nothing of different. All of our women are women. But this morning, I'd like to take this special privilege to acknowledge a couple of women that stand in this house this morning who are not only mothers of our church, but also mothers that have been here and have instilled in us. So the first person, of course, we acknowledged her in Women's History Month. But again, I do want to acknowledge the mother of our church, Mother Adele Scott. Amen. So those who can't see her, raise your hand. That's the mother of our church, y'all. And how old is Sister Scott? She's 89 and looking good. Amen. If we need more, we do have more in the back. Thank you, Sister Jocelyn. So we do want to acknowledge her. We do want to acknowledge the others that are on that board with her. Sister Amy Jackson, amen. Mother, amen. We want to acknowledge Sister Sadie Lambert, amen. We acknowledge her. And we want to acknowledge our oldest mother, if you will, say, here at Mount Nebo, whether she's 94, 95, I don't know. But Sister Bradwell, amen. She walked with us today, but her children held her and kept her. We do now acknowledge, of course, none other than Sister Earlene Washington, who is standing here behind us. We acknowledge her this morning. We thank God for her. Amen. So, you guys good on that side? Okay, we're going to have you all to take a seat. If you did not receive one, please raise your hand that they can get to you. And then we have three other acknowledgments that we just want to do. We want to ask if... Oh, we didn't do that far.
Can the youngest mother stand with a child under 1 year old?
Do we have any mothers that have a child under 1 year old?
Can the youngest mother of a child under 2 years old stand?
Thank you.
Can the youngest?
So we're gonna go to three, and that's a cap.
Can the youngest mother of a child under 2 years old stand?
Well, amen.
That we have a guest. If you could tell us your name, please.
Felicia,
and you're with Sister Washington. Amen. So let's give God a hand clap and praise for that. I don't see my person who was to do the oldest mother, so I'm going to do that. We're going to start at the age of 85. We do have something for you, though, as well. We'll get with you before you leave. Our oldest mother, we're going to start at the age of 85. 85, seasoned and beautiful. Let's go to 90. Look at Sister Gaynor over there. Amen. Do we have someone who is 95?
93.
Go ahead and stand. And this is our long-term. We We adopted slash joined Mount Nebo slash Violet Monroe. Gonna make sure she get the church mother. Amen. So let's give her a hand clap of praise this morning. 93 years old. God bless you. Amen. We're gonna get with you. Now, we had a group that was doing this, but our mother with the most children. Hey, you put your hand down. I didn't want to look that way. I know you. Amen. Because you still look like you 18. So we just. Amen. I know every time when she's on, I cannot believe it. She looks great. So, well, Sister Washington just went ahead and stood up. That's all. All right, Sister Washington, how many children do you have? Sister Washington has 8 sons and 1 daughter. Amen? Amen. So let's give her a hand clap of praise for how God blessed their life. Amen? And we do not forget to, of course, acknowledge Deacon Otis Washington instead as well. Amen? Her husband. And she is 88 years old. Don't y'all forget. She is 88 years old. Amen. So with that, we thank you all so much. Thank all of you. Addie Styles is in the midst of us this morning, so God bless you, and thank you for joining us as well. And with that, Pastor, God bless you and thank you.
Scripture will be read by Minister Caldwell. Let everyone stand for the reading of the word. This morning's scripture will be coming from 1 Samuel, the first chapter, verses 12 through 17. And it reads, "And it came to pass, as she continued praying before the Lord, that Eli marked her mouth. Now Hannah, she spake in her heart, only her lips moved, but her voice was not heard. Therefore Eli thought she had been drunken. Eli said unto her, How long wilt thou be drunken? Put away the wine from thee. And Hannah answered and said, No, my Lord, I am a woman of a sorrowful spirit. I have drunk neither wine nor strong drink, but have poured out my soul before the Lord. Count not thy handmaid for a daughter of Belial, for out of the abundance of my complaint and grief have I spoken hitherto. Verse 17, Then Eli answered and said, Go in peace, and the God of Israel grant thee thy petition that thou hast asked of him. Amen. May the Lord bless the hearers and most of all the doers of his word. You may be seated.
Just want to say happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. We hope you all enjoy this service. I had a dream one night.
Yeah.
I dreamed that I went home to live with Jesus.
Yeah.
And when I got there, one of the first faces that I saw was Mother's face.
Yeah.
And you know, I began to sing a song that I never sung in my life. My song was, Hello, Mother.
Hello, Mother.
Hello, Mother.
Hello, Mother.
But I
just know this morning that the Lord has been good to us. Come on, if the Lord has been good to you, come on, put your hands together and let's give God some praise today. Out of all the things that we've been through, God has been good to us. Amen. Certainly we greet all of you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, but especially our mothers on today. Come on, let's give them some major love today. Amen. We thank God for each of you today. Amen. And I echo what has already been said. If your mother is still here, love on her. Say amen, somebody. Amen. My mom has been gone since 2015. Amen. And I still think about her every day. Amen. She was in the hospital. I remember it very clearly. And we knew that time had already crept in. She had already made her peace with God. And she was on her way away from here. And my sister said, you need to pray. And so in my mind, I see Mama in the morning, not knowing it wasn't going to be the physical morning.
All right.
So I said my little prayer, went home thinking that the next morning I'd come back and we'll talk and we'll chat it up. And all of us left. My brothers, we left the room, went home. And before that next morning, she said, Mama done caught her flight. And she said to the nurse stayed in the room. She said, I'm going to stay in the room with your mom because I don't have a lot of patience. I'm going to stay in the room tonight with her. And Mom said to her just before daybreak, she said, I know you're busy. Won't you go on and take care of some other stuff? She said, no, Miss McKenzie, I'm going to stay in the room with you. She said, no, I got a date with somebody. She said, but I need you to go on and take care of other things. And she said, I left out the room for about 5 minutes. And she said, when I came back, Mom was gone. So don't wait until tomorrow. Because you may not have a tomorrow. Do it now. Whatever it is. Whether it was you in the wrong or whether you think your mom was in the wrong, squash it today. Move past that. You only get one mom. Listen, I'm a dad, I'm a father, and I know mamas have a whole lot more patience than us fathers do. Talk to me, somebody here. We are men and we are taught to be a little bit tougher. But mom has a different kind of love. I ain't saying that as a father you don't love. You love your children dearly. But there's nothing like a mother's love. And I ain't talking about what I heard. I'm talking about what I know, Frank. Love them. You can't never do too much for your mama. Mama gave me money when daddy wouldn't. She's sneaking to give it to me. I played basketball in high school. That boy going on out. He got a game tonight. He gonna need some money to buy him something to eat with. And daddy would say, no, I ain't getting it nothing. Mama said, here, boy, here, take this. She balled it up in her hand and put it in my hand. That's a mother's love. See my mother give her last. And knowing my brothers, they ain't talking about me now. I'm a baby in the family. Y'all sit down. I ain't gonna keep you standing up the whole time I'm talking. Knowing they're gonna cut up, she knew it. They come up with some story about they need money for this, and she give it to them, knowing what the real situation was. That's a mother's love. Amen. Father, we thank you today. We give you honor. We give you glory
forgiven us mothers who love us in spite of ourselves. Thank you, Lord God, for being that kind of God, that you brought women into our lives who, although they may not have been our biological mothers, they have been mother figures, giving us wisdom and instruction on how to navigate the pitfalls of this life. Father, we thank you today. We give you honor, we give you glory, but most of all, Father, we pause now to give you praise. Now, God, bless this preaching moment. Let it be what you would have it to be on today. Fill us now with your Holy Spirit. Let your power fall afresh in this place. For we can do nothing of our own except thou be with us. And so God, take this little lump of clay. Use me for your glory and your praise. It's in Jesus' name we ask and we give thanks. And it is amen.
Amen.
Amen and amen. Amen. I want to call your attention to the scripture that Minister Cornwell read for us earlier. 1 Samuel chapter 1. Perhaps you know this story, maybe not. It's a very great, interesting story. Amen. 1 Samuel. Chapter 1. And I'm going to pick up where Minister Cornwell left off. I want to pick up at verse 18. And she said, let thine handmaid find grace in thy sight. So the woman went her way and did eat, and her countenance was no more sad. Look down with me around verse 24. And when she had weaned him, she took him up with her with three bullocks and one ephod of flour and a bottle of wine, and brought him unto the house of the Lord at Shiloh, and the child was young. And they slew a bullock and brought the child to Eli. And she said, O my Lord, as thy soul liveth, my Lord, I am the woman that stood by thee here praying unto the Lord. For this child I prayed, and the Lord hath given me my petition which I asked of him. Therefore also I have lent him to the Lord. As long as he liveth, he shall be lent to the Lord. And he worshiped the Lord there. I want to talk for a little bit this morning about the ideal mother. Ideal mother. We invest a considerable amount of time searching for the ideal gift. This gift is always predicated upon the occasion, the holiday, the person, and even the budget that we have already allowed it for this occasion. We not only search for the ideal gift, but we search for the ideal job. We search for the ideal mate. We search for the ideal house or place in which we have decided to live and to plant roots and to raise a family. We search aimlessly for the perfect or the perfect place. How does one find the perfect or ideal mother when the choice is not left up to you?
Yes.
Because you really had nothing to do with the night that your mother and your father got together. Say amen when you get home. Today is the day in which we remember the lives of the women who were anointed with a very special and sacred gift. giving life, care, and love to us. The old saying is, the hand that rocks the cradle rules the world. It's true, because it is often the mother that takes that shapeless and selfless lump of human flesh, called a human, and molds it into a person. Today we thank God, for in women he has granted them with the most special and sacred favor, the home and by whose hand God has entrusted the Savior of the world to be cradle crafted and formed. It was Jesus who was born of a virgin called Mary. God entrusted Mary with the living word. Have I got a witness here? Dr. Jeremiah Wright, in his sermon entitled The Audacity to Hope, talks about when he was attending an annual convocation at Virginia Union University School of Theology. There, he says, he heard the preaching, the teaching of Reverend Frederick D. Sampson from Detroit, Michigan. One of his lectures, Dr. Sampson spoke of a painting, Dr. Wright said, that Dr. Sampson spoke of it being a study in contradictions, because the title and the details on the canvas seemed to be in direct opposition. Okay. He said the painting's title is Hope. It shows a woman sitting on top of the world playing a harp. What more enviable position could one ever hope to achieve than being on top of the world with everyone dancing to your music? As you look closer, the illusion of power gives way to the reality of pain. The world on which this woman sits, our world, is one torn by war, destroyed by hate, decimated by despair, and devastated by distrust. The world on which she sits seems to be on the brink of destruction. Famine ravages millions of inhabitants in one hemisphere, while feasting and gluttony are enjoyed by inhabitants of another hemisphere. Yeah. The world is a ticking time bomb, with apartheid in one hemisphere and apathy in another. Scientists tell us there are enough nuclear warheads to wipe out all forms of life except for cockroaches. That is the world in which this woman sits in wax painting. Our world cares more about bombs for the enemy than about bread for the hungry. Have I got a witness here? This world is still more concerned about the color of skin than it is about the content of character. World more thinking about which what's on the outside of your head than about the quality of your education or what's inside of your head. That is the world in which this woman sits. Dr. Jeremiah Wright said. He goes on to say, you and I think of being on top of the world as being in heaven. When you look at the woman in the wax painting, you discover this woman is in actuality in hell. She's wearing rags. Her tattered clothes look as if the woman herself has come from Hiroshima or Nagasaki. Her head is bandaged and blood seeps through the bandages. Scars and cuts are visible on her face, her arms, and her legs. So this morning, my Nebo, as I look at Hannah, we see a woman who has in a time and place where she lived, this was thought to be a terrible hardship. More than that, some believe that it was a disgrace, a reproach, even a punishment or a curse from God. And to make matters worse for Hannah, her husband's other wife did have children, and she taunted Hannah unmercifully. In fact, the text says year after year, she flaunted her children in Hannah's face. Desperately, Hannah prayed for a son. Fervently, she promised that she would give him to the Lord and signify his dedication by leaving his hair uncut. What is often overlooked in this text is that God continued to bless Hannah. The woman that was once barren didn't just have one child, but six children. While she placed the first son in the hands of the priest, she reared the other five under the same vow of spirituality she made with God in the very beginning. She raised her entire family in the fear of the Lord. She taught them, loved them, and provided for them. Though she was a poor woman, God kept his end of the agreement and provided for her to the point that she never saw her seed begging for bread. When you look at Hannah, her name means a woman blessed of God. And so I want to raise the question this morning. What is in the DNA of an ideal mother? What does that DNA look like? The first thing that I detect from this text is that Hannah is a woman who weeps. She weeps not for herself, but for her unborn children. Talk to me, somebody here. Every mother here this morning knows what it's like to have your heart broken by not others, but by your own children. There are times in the believer's life when God seems to withhold from us the very thing that we want the most. For Hannah, that one thing was the joy of being a mother. When you look at the opening verses of this text in verses 1 and 2, we witness the scene of Hannah's story. The text says, a certain man from the hill country of Ephraim, whose name was Elkaniah, verse 2 says, he had two wives. One was called Hannah, and the other was called Peniel. Peniel had children, but Hannah had none. That statement alone is enough for us to understand Hannah's plight and situation. This story doesn't just apply to Hannah, but this story is real for others who have shared Hannah's experience. That they know that this story speaks volumes this morning. It can be hard enough to rejoice when a friend or sister or neighbor has children when that blessing has been withheld from you. But imagine what it would be like to have a competing wife to deal with. In Hannah's day, it was legal for a man to have more than one wife. Y'all better look at me. Get no fancy ideas in your head. Ain't gonna fly today, brothers. Say amen when you get home. I'm just trying to help you. Don't look the other way. Don't start looking across the room. You're gonna have to come up with something. In fact, an inability to conceive was one of the major reasons husbands to take a second wife. Hannah weeps, but she doesn't just weep. Hannah prays. Talk to me, somebody. Her prayer is specific. She asks for not just a child, but she asks God for a male child. Hannah prays a specific prayer. That's a lesson for all of us. When you pray, you got to be specific with God. Don't just assume that God is going to give you what you desire. You got to be specific in your prayer. And so Hannah prays a specific prayer. Lord, keep my child. They're not home. They're out in the world doing all kinds of things. Lord, keep them. Watch over them. Every mother knows what it's like to pray a specific prayer. But not only does Hannah pray a specific prayer, kind of praise, a very serious prayer. She is praying, but you got to read the text in order to pick this up. But her lips are not moving. So much so that she is so deep in her prayer that Eli thinks that she is drunk. And Eli says, how dare you come to church, to the temple, and you have been drinking, and now you are filled with wine. And she says, wait a minute, Eli. I respect your priestly position, but I have not drinking wine nor a strong drink. This is a sorrowful spirit. I'm in deep distress over my condition. And not only am I barren, but my husband's other wife keeps flaunting it in my face. So she prays a very serious prayer. I don't know, does she pray a pacific prayer, a serious prayer? But Hannah prays a sincere prayer. She's sincere. She's not playing. She's not just going through temple rituals and movements. No, Hannah is serious about her condition. And every mother this morning knows that when you reach your limit, there's a time out for playing. It's time for business. Hannah weeps over her situation. She bears the pain of living in a flawed world. Scars and the scratches on her psyche are visible when you look at this text. She cries. She refuses to eat anything because she has no children. She weeps. But the second thing I see, beloved, is she waits. She waits. Look at verses 17, 18, and 19. Then Eli answered and said, go in peace. May the God of Israel grant your petition that you have asked of him. Hannah said, let your maidservant find grace and favor in your sight. So the woman went on her way and ate. Her face was no longer sad. Family got up early the next morning, worshiped before the Lord, and returned to their home in Ramah. Elkanah knew Hannah, his wife, and the Lord remembered her prayer. One of the most challenging tasks of the day is learning how to wait on the Lord. Yeah, you can say amen. We don't like to wait. No, we don't. Because our world has wired us to live with a right now mentality. And we have adapted that mentality when it comes to our relationship with God. We feel and we think that God ought to move on our schedule. And oftentimes God never moves on our schedule. Say amen when you get home. Our society has grown accustomed to imminent and immediate gratification. Help me talk about it. Yeah. Due to modern technology and all of our conveniences, telephones, refrigerators with TVs in them, freezers, microwave, fast food, airplanes, etc., we have many things immediately at our fingertips. I want to throw this out there. This is not in my notes to say this, but I just want to throw this at somebody this morning. Let me just put this disclaimer out there. I'm not after anybody when I make this statement, but I'm just checking the room. How many of us would have survived the pandemic had it not been for Amazon? Amazon got wealthy because we had packages delivered to our houses. Talk to me, somebody. See, y'all don't got upset with me now. I saw more and more Amazon trucks on the road than I ever saw in my life. We might be shut down, but Amazon keep on rolling. And if I wanted to know where the money was going, all I do was follow the Amazon truck. UPS couldn't keep up. FedEx couldn't keep up. No, you got to follow the Amazon truck. Because Amazon was still delivering. We were still going on with life because we had the world at our fingertips. We could go online, order everything we needed, and have it delivered to our house, left on our doorstep. Depending on the time and the item that you order from Amazon, you can get it the same day. We've taken that mentality and we've infused it into our relationship with God, that we think God operates like Amazon. He's a God that you can't hurt. You gotta wait. You gotta give him time. Because when we think of waiting, we think in terms of being in line at an airport terminal. We think of waiting like being at a doctor's office or waiting room at the hospital or the line at the grocery store or being stuck in traffic. Folk don't even do that well anymore. Had I not been paying attention the other day, a guy ran the red light, he would have hit me. But luckily I was driving for him too. And in reality, you got to do that today. You can't just drive for yourself. It's some crazy folk out there. They don't even stop for the red light or the stop sign. They just keep on going. No matter how much we would like for things to speed up, fact remains that sometimes we just have to learn how to wait on God. Every mother knows what it's like to wait because they've waited for that child who said I was going to be home by 10 or should be home by 10 but didn't get home till after 12. Oh no. I know I ain't the only one. Some of y'all done got grown up now and you forgot that you said, Mama, I'll be back home by 10 and 10 o'clock came and you were still joking. Was still having a good time. He was still letting them. I know we in church and I know we serious this morning, but let's take off that artificial mask of spirituality and let's tell the truth today. We ain't always done everything that we so supposed to have done. And even the best child do something different when they're out of the eyesight of mom and dad. Come on in here. Perhaps some of us are waiting for something of great importance this morning. Hannah has prayed and now she must wait in faith that God will move on her behalf.
Yeah.
There are a lot of ways we could respond to disappointment. We could complain about it. We could throw in the towel. But the key is to take a page out of Hannah's book is to stay focused and faithful. Waiting is good for the soul, especially if you're waiting on God. And as you wait, remember that God has not forgotten you. You are on his mind even right now as you sit in the sanctuary. He sees you in your confusion. He sees you in your fear. And even in your distress, God still sees you. Don't despair, but as you wait, rest your weary soul on his everlasting promises. I hear Isaiah this morning saying, they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. God is the ultimate promise keeper. God never makes a promise that he doesn't keep. So Hannah weeps. Then she waits on God. But then one of the most important things that I took out of this text was that she worships. Look at verses 24, 25, 26, and 27. And when she had weaned him, she took him up with her, talking about her son, along with a three-year-old bull and an ephod of flour and a skin of wine, and she brought him to the house of the Lord. Look where she brings him now. After she asked God for this child, she brings him back to God at Shiloh. And the child was young. Then they slaughtered the bull and they brought the child to Eli. And she said, oh my Lord, as long as you live, my Lord, I am the woman who was standing here in your presence praying to the Lord. For this child I pray, and the Lord has granted me my petition that I made to him. God answers prayer in his own time. Let me say that again, because y'all didn't catch it the first time. God answers prayer in his own time. And he does it in accordance with his own purposes. The Lord remembered Hannah. And in the course of time, in due time, she conceived and gave birth to a child. Why did it take so long for Hannah to get what she had asked for? Perhaps maybe that's your question this morning. God, why is it taking so long? Why have you not answered my petition yet? It's because Hannah was part of a larger plan. Y'all should have shouted on that right there. That God has something more, bigger in plan for you. That's why he's waiting. That's why he's making you wait. Because God has a bigger plan for your life. We become so anxious about the concerns and desires of our own lives that we forget that we are part of a much larger plan. Yeah. Hannah worships the one who brought about her deliverance. She worshiped because God heard her prayers. And on this Sunday, Mother's Day, we honor and pay homage to mothers who have wept for and over their children. We pay tribute to mothers who had the patience to wait on that child to come back home. We recognize those mothers who testify that he's an on-time God. Yes, he is. May not come when you want him. But I'm a living witness this morning that he's always right on time. Every mother in here this morning ought to be able to testify that God will make a way. Yes, he will. Watch this now, and I'm about ready to wrap it up so y'all can take your mama out to eat. Let her get whatever she want to get. Amen. It's her day, it ain't your day. Look at this. In the opening of chapter 2, verses 1 and 2, what's this song of Hannah? It's a beautiful song. It's about 10 verses. I'll let you read it at your leisure, but I'll share the first two verses with you. All right. And Hannah prayed, watch this, and said, my heart exalts in the Lord. My horn is exalted in the Lord. My mouth derides my enemies because I rejoice in your salvation. Salvation means deliverance. Means that God has rescued me. God has heard my cry. Watch what she says in verse 2. There is none holy like the Lord. There's no God like Jehovah. Let me put it in your vernacular. There's no God like Jehovah. Watch this. She says, for there is none besides you. There is no rock like our God. She ain't talking about crack cocaine. He's a rock of ages. He's my shelter in the time of a storm. Beloved, don't worry when your dreams don't come true. God still has dreams for you. God still has you on his mind. Your dreams are always better than your dreams. We serve a God that can't be and won't be confined, tied to any place. We serve a God that is neither here nor there, but yet he is anywhere and everywhere at the same time. We serve a God that's so big that you can't go around him. We serve a God that's so low that you can't go up to him. Have we got a witness here? We serve a God that loves us despite all that we've done. That's just like a mother's love. No matter what we've done, mama always has her arms open to receive us back home. Yeah, we messed up royally, but mama said, baby, I still love you. Have I got a witness here? Good day, my Nebo and friends. May the Lord bless you real good. But on my way out of here this morning, I'm reminded of a story of a young man who said to his mother, one day, mama, I'm going all on my own. I'm tired of living under your roof with your rules and your guidelines. And I'm going away into a far country. Mama said, that's fine, but just before you go, let me give you something to take with you where you always remember me. She gave him an old tattered picture. And as a young man went off and lived his life, yes, trouble came his way. Yes, have I got a witness here? And one day she received a note that her son had fell on hard times. Well, you know what mama did? Mama grabbed her old coat and put it on. Grabbed her purse and put it on her arm. Said, I'm going to find my boy. She went in the saloons, but she couldn't find him. She went into the nightclubs, but she still couldn't find him. She searched over and over and still couldn't find him. So she said, well, I gotta get back home, but before I go, I'm gonna take this picture and I'm gonna hang it on every signpost. And if you happen to see my boy, tell him that he can always come back home. Have I got a witness here? And I'm so glad this morning that when we get in trouble, have I got a witness here? God, who is our Lord, always receive us with open arms. Good day, my Nebo. May the Lord bless you real good. But I want to tell you somebody that I'm so glad that God will be a mother for the motherless. My God, he will keep you. If you want to be kept, my God will rock you in the bosom of his arm. Any all right, can you say anybody here glad this morning that the Lord will make a way somehow? I know you may be down, but the Lord will mother is one who weeps for and over her children. Ideal mother is one who waits not just hours, but she waits days, weeks, months, even years for that child, hoping always. She's not sure where they are, had heard from her, have received a car, have received a phone call, but she just keeps hoping that my child is still alive. And I don't care what condition they're in, I just want my baby to come back home. But after God hears that prayer, she doesn't forget God. She goes and she worships him. She said, Lord, I just want to tell you thank you. Anybody in the house this morning just want to tell God thank you for bringing me over the hills and the valleys of life? God, I thank you for waking, watching over me, watching over my children, watching over my grandchildren, watching over all of my family. Thank you, God! We never know what's going to happen, especially today. Especially for African American males, young women. They leave home, but we don't know what's going to happen. Will they get back? We don't know. So in the morning, we pray that they'll be all right while they're out there in the world. Because we can't be everywhere with them. Our eyes are limited. We can't see everywhere they're going. Our arms are short. We can't reach them wherever they go. But God can. God can. God can. We want to come now and extend an invitation of discipleship. There may be somebody here this morning who wants to get to know this God that Hannah prayed to, that Hannah ended up worshiping because he heard her pray. It is this Christ, the risen Savior, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, that we offer to you this morning. If you're here today and you don't have a church home, we invite you to connect with us here at Mount Nebo. You can come by letter, Christian Experience, a candidate for baptism. Make sure at the end of the day that you know God and God knows you, and that you have a right relationship with Him. That's the most important thing. We offer Christ to you today, my brother, my sister. You may be seated. May the Lord extend to you grace and mercy. You didn't take this opportunity. Release this name. We thank God again for each of you today taking the time to come and worship with us. If you are visiting us today for the first time, we greet you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we do extend this invitation to you to join us again at any of our worship services. Amen. We pray that today would not be the only day. Amen. Amen. And certainly always, we're always excited and glad to see members of Mount Nebo come and share, especially on today. Amen. We thank God and pray that all the mothers, that you would have an exceptional day. Amen. God will bless you and keep you. And we extend our love to each and every one of you. May heaven forever smile upon you and grant you your heart's desire. Amen. 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 As we get ready to go, we want to receive our offering. If you need a tithe envelope, if you would please raise your hand and one of our men, ushers, men of order, will come and bring you a tithe envelope, or you can give your contribution today via Givelify. Go to givelify.com, look up Mount Nebo, Missionary Baptist Church, Fort Lauderdale, and you can give it electronically, or you can do that also via Zelle. Or if you're going to pay by credit card or debit card, you can go to Classroom 2 on your right. Someone from our finance ministry will receive you. Will receive you there. Whatever you give, give it from your heart. God will honor and bless that gift. As Luke 6:38 says, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over, shall men give into your bosom. Malachi says, bring you all the tithes to the storehouse, that there may be meat to my house, and prove me now, herewith saith the Lord of hosts. I shall not open for you the windows of heaven, for you are a blessing, and you shall not have room enough to receive. Amen. Come on, let us stand as we get ready to go. God bless you. Keep you is our prayer. Till next time, the ideal mother. Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you for this time that you've loaned us here this morning. Bless us now as we depart from this place, but never from your presence. Go before us, behind us, above us, and beneath us to catch us should we fall. God, we give you honor, we give you glory, and most of all, we give you praise. It's in the wonderful name of Jesus the Christ. We ask it all and give thanks, and it is amen, amen, and amen. God bless you. Have a great week.